Okay, so we get started. I'd like to welcome you and thank you all for coming to this presentation. We only have an hour, but actually less now. Obviously, there's a lot to say about designing online blended courses, but today, for the purpose of this presentation, to just highlight some of the main things you might need to think about and to highlight some supports that are available here in UL for those of you thinking of moving courses online. Okay? By the way, I'm Darina Slattery and I'm a lecturer here at Teaching and Learning Instructional Design. I also teach online as well as on campus and I run workshops, which I'll tell you about shortly. Okay. So in terms of the structure of the presentation, I'll start off by talking about some of the common questions that hopefully you might, I don't know how qualified or how much experience you have at the moment teaching online. Maybe you're just thinking about doing it, or maybe you have been doing it for a long time and you're just looking for some more guidance. But there are typical questions that people ask when they're thinking about teaching online. And some of these questions, it takes several years to even answer them. Even if you're teaching a long time, you are always thinking about how you might do something differently and going to workshops and trying to learn how to do it. So we'll look at some of those. Then we'll talk kind of as a structure then for this presentation. We look at the duo workshop and what we cover on that workshop and how it kind of addresses many of the challenges and things that people are trying to think about when they're teaching online. And then hopefully, if time permits, we'll get you to actually develop an activity that you could use online with your own students, or at least you'll get started on one. Okay? So hopefully you recognize some questions here on that slide. Probably the most common question that people ask first is, you know, can I even teach my module online, my subject or my discipline? It might be a very hands-on module, it could be a very technical module. It is important to say that whenever we're talking to people about teaching online, we're not trying to tell people to replace what they're doing at the moment with online. We're trying to highlight how technology might help you with some or all aspects of your teaching. Okay? So it may be that there are just certain things that you do at the moment face-to-face that might be working or might not be working so well. We're trying to highlight examples maybe, and particularly in the workshop, we highlight examples of how technology might make something more productive than it currently is in a face-to-face environment. Okay? Potentially, any module, any topic could be taught at least partly online. All right? Now, there are lots of different reasons why we might teach online. It could be because our institution is telling us to increase enrollment. It could be because we don't have enough resources to teach your large numbers on campus. You might be able to get room booking. There's a whole lot of reasons why we might be actually forced to teach online. But if we look at it from the other perspective, sometimes we might also choose to teach online or like to offer some or part, you know, part of our programs or modules online. All right? And so even before I was teaching online, I was offering parts of my on-campus module online because I felt the students would benefit more from some of those online activities than they would from the face-to-face activities. Okay? So I suppose the blended fully online, there are lots of terms related to teaching online, and lots of people mean different things, subtly different things by blended and fully online. But let's just stick to the simple. Blended means that some part of it is delivered online. It might be 5% or it might be 95%. Okay? Blended really just means that there's a combination of face-to-face and some online work. Okay, now you'll get lots of people who argue other definitions, but let's just keep it to the simple ones for now. Okay? Or is a course going to be entirely online with no on-campus attendance whatsoever? There's very few of those, even though lots of people say the course is entirely online, because sometimes we need students to come on campus for an exam, or we want them to come on campus for induction. We might make it compulsory, but we kind of encourage it. Okay, so I teach on a graduate certificate that's technically fully online, but yet we have a workshop this Saturday where we encourage people to come to just meet one another and get to know their teachers face to face and so on. Okay? So there are lots of variations about how we might do this. Choosing tools is often the most, probably the question that most people are concerned about, or one of the questions anyway, because there are just so many tools to choose from, and it's really overwhelming. So if you go to an e-learning conference, you will be really excited, but also really overwhelmed by what everybody else is doing in the field. You'll hear people talking about Twitter or Facebook or clickers or blogging or e-portfolios, and you'll think, I'm not doing any of those things. How am I ever going to step into this field? Okay? The important thing to remember is you should only use tools that A, you're comfortable with, but B, that actually more importantly, aligned with the outcomes you're trying to achieve. So it doesn't matter if it's a good old-fashioned discussion forum, even if everyone else is using the latest Web 2.0 tools. It's what you're doing with the tool that matters. Okay, and I can't emphasize that enough. So despite the thousands of tools and apps that are there, pick a handful and get comfortable with those. If you're not comfortable with them, your students will have problems and you won't be able to deal with those problems. Okay? So another question people often ask is what kinds of activities and assessments? You know, how could I move my subject online when I normally have, you know, live debates during my lectures? You know, how could that experience be replicated? You know, I don't need my students to reflect. So for example, with the reflective blogging, lots of people, particularly in science engineering and disciplines, think that reflection isn't something their students would be into or that they want them to do. But yet, when you actually discuss it with them after a while, they end up saying, well, I want them to think about the implications of that science experiment. And the more you probe it, you find out that actually they do want their students to reflect, but they just haven't been calling this, you know, reflective blogging, okay, or they haven't thought about how those tools would also transfer into their discipline, because they tend to be associated with humanities and education disciplines. All right, so things like e-portfolios, they can be used in any course, all right? Reflective blogs, quizzes, lots of people dabble with quizzes because you can create quizzes pretty quickly in most platforms, Scholar, Moodle, and so on. But also another question, and I suppose people maybe don't always think of this question, but it's really important. How am I going to match up all those cool things that I'm getting my students to do with what I said I want them to be able to do? And that's where we tend to get people to focus back on, you said you want your learners to be able to do these five things on completion of your module. What activities could we get them to do that will match up? You don't want to be getting your students to do all these cool things just for the sake of it. You want them to have a purpose. Okay? Some other considerations then, motivating online learners is always going to be a challenge, particularly if we're talking about undergraduate students. Okay? I teach mainly postgraduate students, master's, grad cert students, and it's not too difficult to get them motivated after a couple of weeks of immersion in the online environment. Undergraduate students will pretend they've no questions in class, they'll pretend they've no questions on the forum, and then they'll all line up at the end of the class to ask you questions. Okay? It's much harder to get them motivated, and maybe that's due to things like age and so on, and being used to hand-holding and so on, maybe in secondary school. They're not so good at being independent learners. Okay? So that is a challenge just that I feel I should highlight for you. It doesn't mean it can't be done, but it will be harder. Okay? One of the important differences when you become an online teacher is that you change from being perceived as the expert who comes in and instructs for the class. You change then to becoming an online facilitator, or you should become more of an online facilitator or a moderator. And by moderator here we mean moderating online discussions, because a lot of your work online will be in discussion forums. Even if you have a technical type subject, you can house your activities in a discussion forum. The activities can send the learner away to lots of other things that you want them to do, but they come back and they upload their contribution or their response in the discussion forum. Okay, that's kind of a recommended type approach, and we'll look at that again shortly. In terms of promoting deeper learning and reflection, I'll just give you an example. For me, even with some of my modules that were only face-to-face, I found that when I went into tutorials, unless I had loads of activities pre-prepared for students to do, they never really came with questions and work done. Okay, unless it was like you want to get marks for having work prepared in advance. So it ended up being that a lot of my tutorials were turning into another lecture, okay? And I didn't feel in that 1 hour also that we could get around the room and ask everybody questions and have really deep discussions. So I've moved a lot of my face-to-face tutorials to online discussions where they get a week to answer a question. They get some time to research it. They get some time to read what other people have to say. And they're much meatier kind of sessions than I would have in 1 hour when you're watching the clock. Okay, so that's just one example. And then again, using things like reflective blogs, getting learners to look at their own discussion forum postings and to comment on those in their blogs. You know, yesterday I said I was finding this assignment impossible and I really hate this subject, but today I've hit a breakthrough and I figured out how to do X, Y, and Z, and I'm now starting to get it. And they start to actually look back at what they've said themselves as they've been learning. And that's really useful in lots of disciplines. And even though you mightn't be so concerned about this yet, you will want to, especially if you've tried out something for the first time, you will want to look at, did it work? You know, you might think it was brilliant, but did your students think it was brilliant? They might think you gave them too much work to do. It might be unreasonable, okay? Particularly with your online learners, they're going to be possibly also working, maybe also have family commitments. So they may be logging in at 10 o'clock at night to download your podcast and your slides and all the resources that you've uploaded. And then they have to start doing the coursework that you've asked them to do. Okay, so there's lots of elements that you need to look at. Also in terms of how user-friendly the platform is, could they find things? Did you use them consistently and so on? Because a common challenge for learners is that different lecturers, even on the same program, use Moodle or Solus differently, and it's really frustrating for them. Okay, they actually, the person who uses it really well and effectively makes everyone else look bad. Okay, so that's a common problem. Ideally, everybody in a course would have some kind of agreement in terms of how they might consistently do something. It doesn't mean that everybody has to be using the top of the range everything, but that you put the assignment in the assignments area. Podcasts should always be in this particular folder. You know, some general guidelines and so on. So I suppose using those questions and as the basis, a lot of those kinds of questions inform this Duo workshop as well. So we've to date, I'm the lead facilitator of that workshop. We've delivered 10 of them in the past 10 years. 10 years. In the last 2 years. And the last one was actually only about 2 weeks ago, and they were actually faculty from 5 EU universities attended the Duo workshop because they want to develop an online program on ceramics material science. Okay? But most of the Duo workshops are internal faculty who are either thinking about going online or have a specific need to develop something. So my glamorous assistant, as he asked me to call him, Padraig Hyland here from EdTech and ITD, he also facilitates the workshop because EdTech obviously has a lot of services that they can provide to people that people maybe might not be familiar or aware of yet. So it's a great opportunity for us to discuss what people need, the training they might need, and how we can all kind of get this sorted so that people can get the ground running. So just to give you an idea of the kind of disciplines that have attended the workshops, it's not just for humanities people, which is what people sometimes think. We've had people from all these and many more disciplines. I think it's at least 50 have done the workshop already in so far, more actually since the last one. Okay, so what do we talk about in the Duo workshop? And you might think, well, I'm not in a Duo workshop now, why does this matter? This matters because I'm trying to highlight the kinds of things you're going to have to consider if you're moving online. Okay, so the first one that I mentioned already is we get everybody to start off, or at the very beginning we talk about basic pedagogy in terms of like Bloom's learning outcomes. Quite often people inherit modules and they just reuse the learning outcomes they've been given, or maybe they have written learning outcomes under a bit of pressure for ABRC or something like that, and they haven't really had time to think about, am I actually going to be able to achieve these outcomes in the module? It's one thing saying something in week one, it's another thing actually delivering it throughout the semester. So we get people to list their learning outcomes, we get people to list their assessments and their activities, and to show or to actually critically look at whether or not they are aligned. Okay, because it's not right to say you have certain outcomes for a module if you're going to give 100% quiz or multiple choice at the end, and you're not assessing those evaluation outcomes or those analysis outcomes. Okay? So we do spend a bit of time on the first morning looking at that, and a lot of people actually end up revamping their learning outcomes. And also revamping the kind of assignments they want to issue in light of learning about that. Because, you know, most people in third level do not have a teaching qualification. It's not a requirement. So they never really had the time to be able to consider those kinds of things. Also, we look at tools. And the tools are important because even from a simple level, a lot of people don't know the difference between synchronous and asynchronous tools. Why would you use a synchronous chat session versus an asynchronous discussion forum? So I talked through examples of how you might do that. So just to give you an example, I use the live chat for like a Q&A session, 1 hour every week. So even though I check the discussion forums all week, from 2 to 3 my distance learners know that I'd actually be there to answer the question live. And some of them will wait until that hour to ask me that question to get the immediate answer, even though I could have answered it sooner if they posted on the forum. But they just want that interaction. Okay? So I use the synchronous chat for kind of Q&A. Do you have any questions about the assignments? Are you okay? Can you find the ebook? You'll actually solve a lot of problems if you otherwise get an email from each individual asking you that question. And the great thing about the chat is the transcript is there afterwards. So even if the student doesn't log in now, they can see the transcript anytime during the semester. They can see everything that you've told the other people in the class. And the discussion forums is actually the home for most of the work I would do with my students, even though that work might send them out to a blog or out to a portfolio or out to watch a video or whatever it is. So really for online learners, you need to think about the reality of why are they doing this course online? Possibly because they have a job or possibly because they have other family or other commitments, okay? Or maybe they can't travel to physically too well. But a lot of people teaching online will not want to be restrained by being logged in at a certain time. Okay, their employer might not allow them to watch a live webinar from 12 to 1. So if you have to have a webinar because you have a guest speaker coming in, make sure you record it and you make it available afterwards. Okay, so we look at the different kind of categories of tools. You know, here are some blogging tools that are useful. Here are e-portfolio tools. Related to that as well, we say, you know, it's all well and good saying I'm going to have a reflective blog, but how might I grade a reflective blog? You know, how would I grade that? There are grading rubrics for pretty much everything out there. And I've collected those and I make that available to participants, and I have them in the slides as well. So there are rubrics for grading Twitter tweets. There are rubrics for grading reflective blogs, for podcasts, for everything. Okay, you can adapt those to suit your particular needs. So these are the kinds of common things that people are anxious about. But also a lot of people aren't familiar with MOOCs. Have any of you done a MOOC in the class? Or if you don't know what a MOOC is yet, I'll tell you in a second. Has anybody been in the MOOC? Okay. Usually I get only one or two people have either heard of a MOOC or being in the MOOC. But I guarantee you that when they say it today, you'll probably hear all about MOOCs tomorrow and think, oh yeah, I know that now. MOOCs just stand for Massive Open Online Courses. Okay, and essentially there are lots of platforms where you can access MOOCs. There are MOOCs about basically anything you could imagine. A lot of the top universities, particularly in the US, are offering their on-campus courses as short MOOCs. So all you have to do is log in with your email address or register, and they'll tell you then there's a MOOC on the anatomy of the brain starting in 3 weeks' time, and it's a 6-week course, and you can drop out or drop in and do whatever you want with it. Okay? There are, you'd probably be surprised, but there's probably MOOCs on what you're currently teaching right now. There are MOOCs running on that. And if they're not running right now, you can access the previous MOOCs. The reason why MOOCs are useful to you as a teacher is, firstly, you can learn about something you've always wanted to learn about. But secondly, you can see how other people are teaching what you're teaching. And you get brilliant ideas of how, God, I've never thought of using that case study in my topic. Or, you know, that's a really creative way of teaching that. It gives you free access to how other universities are doing things. Okay, so MOOCs are very helpful in that regard. It does kind of refresh you. And as I said, you can do a MOOC and not finish it. You're not under any obligation to finish it. If you do, there are some incentives like digital badges and so on, which I can talk to you about another time. But it's a very useful resource to access as an online teacher. And also, you can direct your students to MOOCs. So let's say you know you have to cover a topic that's a bit tricky, but there's a MOOC running right now on that topic. You can get your students to log into the MOOC and watch Harvard's teach them about that particular topic that you find tricky. You know, there's loads of ways we can be creative about that. Also, lots of people aren't familiar with learning object repositories, even though there are people, you know, even probably in this room here who have contributed to them. So Merlo, and there's lots of other repositories where other academics have created learning objects, which might be slides, they might be video clips, it might be animations, it might be a diagram or a definition, any of those would constitute a learning object. And they've actually put them up in a repository for anybody to access. And the great thing about these repositories is that you not only can use them, sometimes you can even adapt them and tear them apart and do whatever you want with them. But they'll tell you what you're allowed to do with them. They also tell you how you to attribute them. Okay, so you probably all spend a lot of time creating learning objects for your students only to just share them with your students and not make them available to anyone else. You don't have to share them with anyone else, but just know that other people do share and you could access their stuff at the very least. Okay, so you know, making people aware of all these sources This could save you invaluable time. You spend sitting down in front of Articulate and creating a 20-minute, you know, screencast or e-learning presentation when somebody else might have done that already and you're allowed to use it. Okay? We also talk about best practice guidelines. For those of you who might be here at 1 o'clock, I'll be talking about that for 5 minutes, very fast, 5 minutes of best practice. But there are lots of things that sometimes people say to me, you know, what should my e-learning or my online course look like? What's the best way to do it? So they kind of hope that somebody's going to say, you should use this color background and you must have 20-minute podcast and you must have a case study every week. There aren't any guidelines like that. There are some recommendations, but the most important thing is that you're consistent, that you put things in the same place that you normally put them in, that you signpost things, that you give clear instructions, that you tell students how to communicate online. That's going to be a big problem, because if you don't give them guidance on that at the start, they'll be talking like they're on Facebook or something in their chat rooms, and you'll be trying to decipher the content from all the other events that are going on in their lives and so on. So there are lots of kind of guidelines that, I suppose, from my own experience as being an online teacher and also from research, things that you should try and avoid or you should try and do. Okay, and if anybody wants to ask me, I can talk about them afterwards. I suppose a major part of your role is that you're going to now become, whether you like it or not, going to be probably more of a moderator, an e-moderator or a facilitator. Because you probably will be using discussion forums and not with your students. So instead of coming in and giving a 1 or 2 hour lecture and then being done with that group until next week, you'll find yourself spending more time in front of the computer teaching them via the discussion forum or answering questions about your podcast lecture in the forum or in the chat. Okay? So you will be, it'll feel nearly more like a one-to-one thing, and it will seem like a huge amount of work at the start. It does get easier because you get smarter about how you do it. You end up, as time goes on, you'll issue smarter assignments that you've tested on previous cohorts, and after a while you'll start to realize that they're actually able to answer each other's questions because you've written such a good assignment. Okay? So you won't find yourself, you know, struggling with some new activity that you hadn't really thought out properly, which is what often happens when you issue a new assignment the first time. You think you've thought it out, but it's not until your students actually sit down to do that assignment that you realize you didn't really understand what I meant there, I wasn't clear enough. Okay? So e-tivities, which I'll talk about again in a few minutes, are discussion forum-based activities. And as I said, they don't always have to be about discussing something. They can redirect a learner to reflect a blog, to watch a case study or a YouTube video. They can tell a learner to go away and collect soil samples, take photos, come back and upload them to the e-tivity. Anything you imagine can be, it just howls within the discussion forum. Okay? And what's nice about e-tivities is you don't have to download anything extra because they're already in your platform. Discussion forums are there already. All you need to do is create a new posting and have certain key headings in the e-tivity and then just write a good e-tivity. So it's back to your instructional design or your course planning like you normally do. Now, that's easier said than done. I mean, writing an e-tivity, I've written 2 in the past week. They both took a few hours each. But the great thing about e-tivities is you can reuse them next year. All you have to do is change the date, deadline, or and it's actually like an object you can reuse next year that you know has worked with your students. And the better your activities are, the I suppose the better the learning experience and also the less work you have to do afterwards. And it's reusable. That's a great thing too. Another thing that we think is really important for people plotting out courses, and initially people are a bit hesitant about storyboarding in terms of, you know, flip chart paper and so on. Not everybody feels they benefit from those kinds of experiences. But actually, how many of us really have the time to stand back from our email and our computers and say, this is what I'd like to cover in this module, this is where the assignments would fit in. It may be that you have to have certain assignments in your module for Teaching Council or Engineers Ireland accreditation. But then, when you look back at that and you realise it's very heavy at one end, there's nothing really, the student has to do nothing until the end of the examination, for example, how might I integrate some activities along the way? Because you're going to have to do that with your online learners. They will not want to just log in every week and look at loads of slides and listen to loads of audio. Okay? Or they will do that, but it will not be motivating. They will drop out. They will feel overwhelmed because it's just like reading a book, to be honest. Okay? You need to get them to do things on a regular basis. And those doing things could be very small things, but they need to feel like they're applying what they're learning more regularly. Because they're feeling a lot more alienated than your average face-to-face student. They don't get to go for a coffee break afterwards and have a good whine about your assignment that you just issued them and solve all those kind of problems. Okay? They're not going to post all their problems on the forum because they'll think that they're the only person with that problem. Okay? So you need to keep them engaged so that they can have a benchmark as well to work on. And another very important thing, I suppose, as well, is as we approach near the end of our workshop, we think probably the biggest challenge people have with teaching online is they go to a workshop, they hear all the great things they could do, but then they go back to their office and they're staring at a blank screen and it's like, what do I do now? I don't know how to create a podcast, I'm not really familiar with Solace, or you know, I don't know what kind of online activities I could have for my topic. We need people, again, the workshop, to actually have listed the things that need to be done next. Like, I need to record a podcast introducing the module. I need to get training on how to create a podcast. Where will I get it? I'll get it from EdTech in ITD. Okay? So you're kind of identifying what gaps you have, what needs to be done. Do you need to write a script for something? Do you need to find a case study for the activity you're going to get learners to do in week two? Okay? So by actually taking the time, and that's what people usually benefit from the most in this workshop, they get the time away from their offices to come here, usually, and to work out what it is they'd actually really like to do. And then they can ask us how might we get support, or is there training, or can ITD offer something like this, and so on. And they're always amazed that those things are actually there, they are available. Okay? So these are, I suppose, some of the major things that you need to think about, you know, if you're talking about moving online. Okay? It is important you don't end up getting overwhelmed by the volume of tools, that you see some examples of what other people have done, and that's what we usually do in this workshop. You see examples of what other people have done with an e-portfolio or a blog, and then you can say, oh, I can see how that could be adapted to my particular discipline. Okay? Because that's usually where the stumbling block is. Well, it's all well and good them talking about that. They're teachers or they're training teachers. I teach, you know, physics. But, you know, we're building a repertoire as well of activities and assignments that we can kind of share with people. So we're working on that side of things too. So I just want to hone in on the activities a little bit more for a few minutes, just in terms of what they are. And this is, as I said, this is a tool without being something you have to install. This is something that you can use in your course, even with your on-campus students right now. Okay, so I've used e-activities with on-campus students to get them to do work, and they get a week or whatever to do it. But they go to the Solace and they look at the e-activity in the forum. Okay, and then when they upload their submission, everybody else can see and comment and so on. They don't see each other's grades or anything like that. Okay, so what are e-activities? I've mentioned already they're based in a discussion forum. They have very detailed instructions, and the skill is in actually writing the proper instructions. What's really easy for you to do is a lot more challenging for a student who doesn't have that knowledge yet. Okay? And usually when people start writing an activity, they realize, God, to actually tell somebody what I want them to do, I actually have to be quite explicit. You might think that spoon-feeding your learners a little bit, but without it, believe me, with online learners, you will get a barrage of emails about the activity that we don't understand. Where will I find it? Where should I post it? How many words? When is it due? You're better off to put the time into creating a good activity in the first place. Okay? And also, you as the e-moderator, you need to be keeping an eye on those activities to make sure, A, that people are able to do it, and B, that if they're going off track, that you can redirect them. Let's say it's a discussion-based, you know, an activity about a discussion. You're going to need to correct them if their discussion is going off track. Or you're going to need to stimulate new strands of thought and so on. Okay? So what does an activity contain? So as I said, this is just a new posting in a discussion forum. So you have some kind of a title, okay? Julie Salmon, who is the mother of activities, she would suggest, you know, having something really catchy. I'm not so good at having really catchy activity titles. This was about as enthusiastic as I was able to get. But in this case, this was an early icebreaker activity on how do you learn. Now, the purpose of this activity was to get all my learners to do an activity and to respond in the right place by the right time and to do something that was reasonably easy for everybody to do. So this activity, which I'll show it to you in a second, how do you learn, is one that could be used in any course because any learner should be able to think about what kind of a learner they are. Okay, so that's an icebreaker type activity. Another activity that's often used at the start that you could use in your courses would be one where you get them to post a bio about themselves or why they're doing this course. You know the kind of thing that you often get people to do when they come into your classroom and you say, could you each just introduce yourselves and tell us a little bit about where you're coming from? Make that an activity. You're going to have to move that stuff online if your students are only online. Okay? So then ideally you have some kind of a spark. It could be an image about whatever the activity is about. It could be a controversial statement. It could be a quote from Trump, for example. Okay? It could be a little clip to a video clip on YouTube that shows somebody doing the thing you want them to be able to do. It could be a case study about Coca-Cola that you found on YouTube. You know, YouTube is actually great for finding little things. Learners love to watch a YouTube video before they do something for you. I don't know why. I'm sure there's research study on it somewhere. Or it could be some kind of challenging, stimulating kind of sentence, okay? Like a controversial statement for your discipline that you want them then to explore or research. The purpose is basically where you just put in written form what the objective of that activity. So you actually tell them why you're getting them to do this. And that's something that a lot of people have objectives and so on in their module outline at the start of week one, but they never for the rest of the term tell anybody why they're getting them to do the things that they're getting them to do. And that's one of the reasons why students don't always understand why you're getting us to do all this work. They think it's just to add up to 100%. Okay? If you can say, the reason why you're doing this activity is because it will require you to interview a teacher and practice using your technical skills by uploading a podcast of the interview, whatever it is you're trying to get your learners to do, they will say, all right, I can see now. That's actually a line I could use in my CV. Okay? The task then is the individual student part, where the student does whatever it is you tell them to do. So you have to specify in steps. Number one, go to this place. Number two, you know, write a 100-word paragraph about whatever. Number three, as a reply to this forum, post your contribution. Okay, whatever it is you want the learner to do. Or you might want them to go in, collect soil samples, and come back and upload pictures of the soil samples and discuss them. Okay? So that's where the individual does what you tell them to do. Ideally, then you'll also have a response part, which is where they go sideways. They don't just do what you told them to do. You ask them then a few days later to look at, let's say, two of your classmates' contributions and comment on them or reflect on them or say whether you agree or disagree or whatever. A lot of students initially don't like having to look at what anyone else is doing because they're overwhelmed enough with what you're asking them to do. But for it to be an active community of learners, they actually need to interact with other students. This has benefits for you as well, because as that community starts to grow, you will find that they will start answering each other's questions and you will not have as much work to do. Okay? So even though I'm not on the discussion forums the weekend, when I come in on Monday and I might see, oh, there's four new messages or whatever, I'll often go in and realize that the four new messages are Mary answering John, who answered, you know, Jane and so on. They've actually found the thing they were looking for, or they've pointed to the ebook that they found online and so on. Okay? You have to kind of create that environment at the start by getting them to seek each other out. Otherwise, an online learner will log on to a computer and only want to hear what you, the instructor, said. Okay, what you have said as the instructor. Okay, but as they start to realize that, God, Mary was really helpful that last time when I was doing that assignment, this might be handy for her project on X, I'll share this with her. Okay, there needs to be a lot more of that online. Otherwise, online learners tend to feel very isolated and alienated. And the problem is you won't know about it until they've actually signed their exit form and they've dropped out. Okay, because they'll just think it's them. They'll think they're the problem. When actually it's the whole experience of logging in solitude late at night and seeing this huge volume of messages and not knowing if you're on the right track. That's what will actually be putting them off. Okay, so they're the majors. So literally in a discussion forum, somebody, you can write the word title. You know, you write the title in, you write in the spark or you have a link to a YouTube video. The purpose of this activity is to, here are my instructions, this is how I want you to respond to each other, and you have created an activity, and you can literally copy and paste that activity and use it again next year. Okay? And every time you write one, next year you'll find a slightly better way of saying it, particularly if there's a few questions about it and so on. So, I know now we started about 10, 15 minutes late, so am I still okay for time? Okay, so I'm going to just do is show you two activities. I have loads on my website that you can go and have a look at. But just for an example, I don't know what your disciplines are, so I was trying to think of one that might be applicable to different disciplines. One of them I just issued a few weeks ago was trying to get my online students to form a team because they had to develop an e-learning course as part of an online team. They're never going to meet each other, probably. Okay? Now, you know yourselves with on-campus students, you tell them you have to form a team and you have things to do. They could take 6 weeks to just find three teammates. That's my experience anyway. But my students, by the way, always get marks for each teaching. That's really important. Okay? Otherwise, they'll see it as just this extra hassle. I would have at least good 20% of every module would have activities, or 20% would be awarded through activities. And I might have four or five of them in the term. If one is particularly hard, it'll be worth more than the other ones. Okay? So I have an activity on how to form a team and propose a topic. So I didn't have the luxury in that particular module of being able to teach them all about teamwork, how to form a team, how to form a team, how to deal with conflict, how to evaluate your own strategies and so on for working as a team. So I used the activity as the basis for directing them to other resources that would teach them that. Okay? So I'm just trying to narrow, sorry, it's a bit blurred there, isn't it? Maybe I'm marginally better there, can you just go see it? Okay? So this activity was just to get everybody to form a team and propose a topic. Okay, so I wanted to generally quickly introduce them to project management and how to work effectively in teams. I directed them to some articles that I thought would be helpful to them. But also they know that the purpose of this activity is to actually meet to form a team for me, for this module. Okay, so this activity is going to make you do that. So I tell them when it's due, and I usually say 9 o'clock at night for distance learners. They may be at work during the day. Those few extra hours in the evening could mean all the difference. It's no good saying 5 o'clock in the day to a distant learner because they're probably still at work or collecting children or doing something. So those few extra hours can help. Or midnight. But I won't be online at 9 checking. I used to be, but I've learned to just not be. Don't log into Solus because they'll see you're logged in at that time. So this is where then I give. Now I might go fairly detailed there, but you actually have to be kind of specific about what you want them to do and where if you want them to do it right. Okay? So I'm not going to read it all to you, don't worry. But basically the first step is I want you to read about time management strategies by looking at this link. Okay? Second step is have a look at how teams form. So Tuchman is quite famous for team formation and so on. Or this guide for students, how they might work in groups. I want them to be aware as they're entering into this project that they're going to have challenges and that they, you know, there are certain guidelines for working as a team. Okay? I said then, you're going to need to pick tools for collaborating in this team. So take a look at this list of tools that I have available. Okay? And I give them some personal guidance as well in terms of these tools I found particularly handy. And then I tell them, when you've done that, you have to reply to this thread with your list of team members and the topic you're going to explore. Okay? So it took ages to write that, like a few hours to write it. I thought I might be being over specific. But in the end, they all wrote back and said, hi, Darina. Our team members are A, B, C, and D, and our topic is X. That's team one done. And they've written marks for that. They've done what they had to do and so on, and there was no confusion about it. And that was all done within a few days of the issue of the activity. Whereas otherwise, if you say to students, you need to form a team now, and you have a project due in week 12, some people will put that off and so on, and you won't get that kind of engagement. I need them to have a team formed by that week, because 2 weeks later, they have to submit something else as a team. Okay? So that's just one example. And the other one I'll just show you for a second is one of, not for my discipline, supply chain management. And this one is on basically getting somebody, because the students on this master's in supply chain management might be working, or most of them are working in supply chain management. She wants them to go and identify a supply chain for their particular industry. To upload a diagram of it, she tells them how to attach it because she's using Moodle, so she gives the instructions for how to use it. And then the second part, she has a statement about the importance of aspects of supply chain management and comment on this in no more than 200 words. Okay, so sometimes if part two is dependent on you completing task part one, you have to specify different dates for the two parts. Okay, and then also she has them doing a bit of a reflection as well in the discussion forum. So do you kind of understand the idea behind a discussion, an activity? It can get you to go away and do anything, but you want them to come back and show evidence of the thing they've done. So that evidence might be uploading an audio clip of an interview that they've done with somebody in the industry. It could be them uploading their opinion about something. It could be anything. But you tell them what you want them to do in the discussion-based activity. Okay? So I know this is kind of rushed, but I only had an hour. So they're just some ideas. So what I want you to do is, if we have, I mean, if you're the one starting at one.
Well, lunch starts at one.
Okay, so we should that first.
You got the template.
So even if you see how far you get just for a few minutes.
Thank you very much.
They're the key headings that you need to have in the activity. So if you can think about, for your own discipline, something that you maybe currently get your learners to do, even if you just start drafting it now. Something that you maybe get them to do in class, but you're now going to have to get them to do as online learners. You're going to have a purpose for that activity. You're going to have to, don't worry about the spark at the moment, because that's something you might have to do a bit of a Google search to find something that kind of is eye-catching or a video clip that's related to that. You're just certainly going to have a purpose for your activity. The task is the hard part, where you list out the steps of what you want the learner to do and where. Okay? So I want you to watch this video clip. Two, in 400 words, I want you to post what you think about this particular statement. Okay, so if you just want to keep it as a simple discussion topic, now you can. And the response part then is due a few days later, where you get them to go and seek out other people's contributions. So they have to go and read, let's say, any two other contributions by their classmates, and either comment on ones they agree on or ones they disagree on. So you're getting them to do what you want them to do, but also go left and right. Okay? Okay. So if you can have a think, or if you want to do one together, if you're in similar disciplines or anything else, there's no problem. What's your discipline?
Medical school.
Medical school, okay. So what kind of, you do a lot of problem-based learning. So
yeah.
What kind of activities do you get them to do in the classroom that you might want to move online? Can you think of any?
I think we could probably do things that we would like to do or think we do that we don't have time to do, so that even things like, you know, they're obviously in small groups.
Okay.
Seeing if you get them in advance to think about functioning and
well, that's the thing. They could do the activity before they've moved your live face-to-face session. So don't you know, you might have a blended environment, so you want them to have some work prepared. So you structure an activity that has to be done the night before they come in to meet you tomorrow. And then when you come in, you say, now that's great, I've had a look at all your contributions, let's have a discussion now about your postings. John, you said to make some interesting points about X, and you can have it printed out yourself and so on. And that can be, so it's like flipping the classroom, you're kind of availing of the activity and using it to flip the classroom. Okay? I know this is only an hour, so like this, we normally do this in 2 days. Okay? So it's just trying to give you some sparks of things that might be useful. We can talk more if you want to know any more about it. What about you ladies there?
What platform do you use?
Actually using Slattery, that's the official UL one, but this can work no matter what platform.
No.
We just create a new discussion room for the same thing. Because all you need to have is these headings in a forum posting. And just write it really well. That's what's great about it. Nobody has to download or install anything. Okay? It's the work here goes into planning what it is you want your learners to do rather than what tool they're using to do it. Okay? I definitely think it would work really well for your environment.
I teach the two midwives, and
okay.
So there's loads of opportunities here, and I am, you know, using online a bit. I think it's fantastic. I suppose I run into that around the assessment and marking. So I'm delighted with the fact that you said you had, you know, different groups.
Oh, the rubrics.
Yeah,
they're all at the end of my slides. So I can email the slides to everybody.
Brilliant.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know that is, you know.
And usually what happens is, I mean, same with myself, I've made up my own rubrics only to realise afterwards other people have theirs online. So why not say, well, that's really important to me, that's not so important to me, I'll make up my own one based on other people's ones.
So it's just that it's in a student's query, then
yes.
That's where you need something.
You know yourself, if you look at something like a reflective blog, you know the next piece or not, but that's not enough for an external examiner or for a student
who's
going to query.
And that's another point too, I know, I'm sure we could run all day, but for external examiners and what they want and everything, you need that.
And all you need is one student as well to say, well, if you had told me that's what you were looking for in my reflective blog posting, I would have produced it. You know what I mean? So ideally, we need to be moving towards actually releasing all this stuff to start. We tend to do it for normal assignments. When we're dabbling with new technology, we're kind of a bit unsure ourselves about how we might use it or evaluate it. We're kind of testing it. but that's not enough for students. Like, they want to know, why did I only get a C? I thought I did what you asked me to do, you know?
No, so, that's great, yeah.
Okay, I'll make those available.
Thanks very much.
Great. Are you all in the same areas or?
No, I'm actually a student. A
student, no?
Yeah, I'm not a teacher at all. Like, I probably just misunderstood the titles.
Okay.
I was hoping that I would learn more about how to put together your own curriculum, depending on your interest. So, I've been watching online tutorials or taking part of modules on Coursera.
Yes.
And EDX.
Yeah.
And I was hoping that I'll know more about the
how to create a course to put up on the MOOC.
No, yeah, to participate.
How to be an online learner as opposed to be an online teacher. Okay.
Yeah. But this is everything you've said so far is still an interesting. Like, I am going to set up a blog and do podcasts.
Okay. Okay, well, then get in touch with me if you have any more questions or anything like that, you know, do, like, because I'm doing research in this area as well, so I'm happy to talk to an online learner about what you want as well. Okay, here you are. Are you in the same?
I'm actually an interviewer. I'm an interviewer.
Okay, yeah.
I suppose maybe just trying to get the most out of it, through an online thing.
What discipline are you working in? Where are you working?
In the business school.
Business school, okay.
So I suppose really what the most you can get out of college.
Basically, like, even though people have looked at most of the college, you can actually do anything you want to do in college too. It's actually what you do. It might look as pretty, but it will look better in the new version.
Yeah, okay.
The new version has more, a bit more of a kind of moodle
interface.
Better interface, more 3D kind of feel to it, and you can chunk things and so on. So I think people will see, and Angelica and Paula know a lot about this themselves, but I've dabbled with some of the tools, and certainly it's more user-friendly.
You have no podcasts?
Oh yes, I do it all the time. Yeah, yeah. There's just podcast tool you just turn on and the edit side tools. Yeah. And there used to be a limit on the file side, there isn't really anymore, so I could have a 2-hour podcast uploaded from a live double lecture or whatever. There's no problem there. And there's a link as well that you get when you upload the podcast. The student who uses iTunes or anything, they can copy that link in and download the podcast.
Okay.
But as soon as you, so even if you don't get to upload it when you planned on uploading it, as soon as you do upload it, it will appear in their iTunes or podcatcher too. There's lots of nice things about that. So if you have any questions about specific things you're trying to do, let me know. I'm doing this myself as well. Okay? Michael.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about the sort of connection between the last session and this session.
Okay.
But I don't know that I'm more inclined toward blending for English literature.
No.
Just the idea that I spend a lot of time in tutorials, I can say I waste a lot of time in tutorials getting people to respond to texts in class. I'm just thinking about ways to have them to prepare their response to the comments.
Well, the e-tivity would be a way to kind of flip the classroom that you need to do this before you come into me, and you're going to get marks for doing it, or you're going to lose marks if you don't do it.
Most students come into this with a bit more confidence.
Yeah.
And their own ideas about bigger pieces.
Because people are afraid to speak up in class when they're not sure if their answer is right, or they're not sure if they read enough. So we would definitely want that kind of environment. I know, sorry, we're going to cut the time. I'm going to email this slide. I think I have all your names. Yeah, great. I'll email them all to all of you, and there are links there, including the links to all the categories. Okay? Sorry for having to rush.
No, thank you.